So first of all, I would like to start by a quick experiment. How many of you have ever heard about multidimensional scaling before seeing my abstract? Can you please raise your hand if you have already heard about it? Okay, I see a few hands. Yeah, I will try to improve this number during my talk. So briefly, as a short introduction, multidimensional scaling is a way of visualizing data when we only know the pairwise distances between the items which we would like to visualize. We don't know their actual position and their actual attributes. So first of all, I will give you some motivation and introduction to why you actually need this algorithm and this idea, and then later we will talk about the linear algebra which is needed for the algorithm. After that, we will see some other alternatives for cases when it's not really possible to do this perfect arrangement of the points, and then we will see some nice applications. So first of all, in data science, there are some common patterns which we face quite often. So one of the objectives is very often to reduce the dimensionality of the data we have. It's usually very hard to interpret the data in a raw format. It might have many attributes, it have many dimensions, but we people can think just for up to three dimensions. So it's a common goal to reduce the dimensionality. Also, another one is to find some factors, some interpretable factors, which drive the behavior of the data. So some factors which we can understand that underlies the actual numbers. And also clustering, something we learned in 1A algorithms. We very often want to see what items are close to each other, what items are related, and what are very much different. And we will see that the objective of multidimensional scaling is actually very similar. So more precisely, by multidimensional scaling, we would like to find answers to one of these three questions, or to even more of these three questions. But one important thing to note is in data science, we often have the data in a form as a list of items with some attributes attributed to that. But this is not the case here. So in multidimensional scaling, we know only the distances or differences between items, and we would like to find out how to place these items in a space such that we preserve the pairwise distances between them. And after doing this arrangement of the points in the space, we would like to find some pattern in it, understand the dimensionality, the factors, and maybe see some clustering motifs. So more precisely, mathematically, what we have as an input, we have a distance matrix where we store the pairwise distances, and as an output, we would like to arrange the points in some dimensions. You can see a simple example here in the figure. If you look at the second one, we can see the matrix, and then we can see the triangle below. They are clearly matching, and it was a very easy case which we can do by hand as well. Let's look at a better example. Here we know the distances between some cities in Europe, and then we would like to reproduce the map of Europe. We can see that running this multidimensional scaling algorithm to visualize the data, we could more or less reproduce the map of Europe. There are some issues. If you know geography very well, then it's not perfect, but it's not too bad either. And now let's turn to a more real-life example. So basically, one of the motivations for multidimensional scaling is that humans are much better in comparing two items and telling how different they are than actually to assign a number to each of them. So for example, in color vision, if you ask a person how different blue and red are, they say, yeah, it's very much different. and how different yellow and green, yeah, they are still much different, but they are not as much different. So this is something people can do much better, and this is a motivation. And in this case, there was an experiment run where people were asked about differences between colors, and this way a matrix could be constructed where an entry corresponds to the perceived difference between color A and color B. And here we come to a very important point, that it is not always mathematically possible to create an arrangement of the points, even in many, many dimensions, such that they adhere to the distances in the distance matrix perfectly. We will come back to the more precise mathematical definition of this later, but yes, so it's important to bear in mind that it's not always possible to create an arrangement such that if we read out the distances from our arrangement, it perfectly matches the input distance matrix. And it's very common, especially when the input distance matrix is coming from human perception. In this case, on the figure, you can see the CIs, they are the colors. Here there are 14 colors plotted. And what the experiment was is that starting out from the input distance matrix, they wanted to plot the colors in some dimensions. And it turned out that if they tried to do it in just one dimension, then it was very, very bad, and they couldn't even approach the desired distance matrix. So anyway, they tried to put the colors on one line, the distances were very much different to the desired distance matrix. But when they went to two dimensions, it suddenly changed, and in two dimensions, we could get an almost perfect reproduction of the desired distances. And if we move to three dimensions, we don't get a much better precision. So what does it mean for us? It means that human beings actually think about colors along two dimensions, which is very exciting because physically, color is a one-dimensional thing. It depends just on wavelength. But as we also learned in 1A graphics, we people think about color in a different manner. And this experiment also proved that we humans think about it in at least two dimensions. Now let's turn to the actual mathematical algorithm. It's very important that for this algorithm, we will assume that there exists a perfect arrangement of the points, which completely reproduces the desired distances. We will later turn to the case when it's not possible. So as an intuition, let's first consider the inverse problem. So assume we have the points in the space in some dimensions, and we would like to get the distances. How can we do that? Well, this is not too difficult. So first of all, let me introduce some notation here. By DIY, I will call the entries of the input distance matrix. So it's simply the distance between point I and point J. And let's construct a matrix D2, which has entries DIY squared, so the squared distances. And we are looking for an arrangement of points as a result. And let's look at the final result, which is now just hypothetical, because we don't have it yet. But let's call the points of the final result as x1, x2, and up to xn. And these will be vectors whose entries will be the coordinates of that point. So if in a final arrangement, one point is at coordinate 2, 3, then it will have a vector which has entries 2, 3 in it. And we would like to construct, starting out from this notation, you can already see in the second line how we can actually go from the points to the distance. It's simply taking the product, the scalar product of the vector between point I and point J with itself, and thereby getting the square distance between the two points. And this is fine, but later on during the algorithm, we will see that it's much more comfortable to work with matrices. So we would like to somehow transfer this equation into a matrix form. To do this, we introduce a matrix capital X, which has columns x1 up to xn, And again, to emphasize, this is what we are looking for. So we are looking for these x vectors, which are the points in the final arrangement. So this x matrix is also just hypothetical. And in order to reproduce the first two terms of the right-hand side of the first equation, when we have xi transpose xi and xy transpose xy, we need some trick to transfer it to matrix format. So basically, we create a column vector z, which contains the length of the points, length of the vectors in the final arrangement. So if we have a point at coordinates 3, 3, 4, then in the vector z, the entry will be 5 squared, which is 25. And this way, and also we have the one vector which is full of ones. And this way, after some checking, we can see that if we take z times 1 transpose, then it will actually have the entries xi transpose i in its content. So this way we can perfectly reproduce the above equation in matrix form. I did not go into much detail here, but it's not too important. So our goal is we have the solution in one direction. And what we would like to do now is to somehow reverse this equation. And instead of solving it for diy, we would like to solve it for xi, for the x1 up to xn, starting out from the di's. So basically, we can say that we are looking for the matrix x, which exactly contains x1 up to xn. And now, very important point is that we are looking for a solution where the points in the final solution are centered. What does it mean that it is centered? It means that the averages of coordinates are all zero. So if we take coordinate number one, then the average of this coordinate along the solution points is zero. Why is it important? So it's very important to see that if we take our final solution and then we rotate it or we translate it, so do a rigid transformation, then it does not change the pairwise distances. So this means that there are infinitely many possible solutions, and we would like to restrict ourselves to one which at least fixes the translation, that we translate it exactly to the center. And finally, for the intuition, we can see from the equation that it's ideal to solve the problem in two steps. So first, starting out from the matrix D2, we will try to find X transpose times X, which is one element of the equation. And then from X transpose times X, we will try to find out X, our final solution. But again, we know just D2 at the beginning. The algorithm to do this is called Torgerson algorithm. So first, we take the equation we looked at the previous slide, and we do a linear algebra trick here to get x transpose x on one side and a function of d2 on the other side, because d2 is what we know, and we would like to find out x transpose x. The idea is that we multiply both sides by the centering matrix J, and we multiply also from the left and also from the right. The centering matrix, what it is doing is that if we multiply a matrix by the centering matrix, then it subtracts the column means from all the columns of the matrix. If we multiply by J from the left, then it subtracts the row means from the matrix. And this way, we can see that something amazing happens. And also, we multiply by minus 1 over 2 both sides. So the left-hand side simply becomes minus 1 over 2 times J times D2 times G times J. And on the right-hand side, the first term and the second term will simply disappear. Why is it? If you look at the first term and we multiply it from the right by J, then it will remove the column means. But we can see that there is already a column vector 1, which took part in constructing the matrix Z times 1 transpose. And you can think of it as basically removing the mean from the 1 vector gives us back a 0 vector. And this way, multiplying by a 0 vector gives back nothing. So we can omit that term. Again, it was not too precisely derived, but at least you can see the intuition. And this happens. The same happens for the second term, but here multiplying by the left cancels out this term, because if you multiply it by the left, then it kind of cancels out the one vector. And what happens with the x transpose times x? Well, first of all, we are looking, as we mentioned, we are looking for a centered solution. And this means that x, and hence x transpose times x, will already have zero row and column means if we assume that our solution is centered. This is not hard to see that if you multiply two centered matrices if you multiply x by x transpose and x is centered, then x transpose times x will be centered as well. And hence, applying the centering matrix on it does not have any effect. So, after all, what we have is that the right-hand side simply becomes x transpose times x. And this is exactly what we wanted to achieve after the first step. So, once again, if we start out from D2, and then we apply this algebraic trick of multiplying by j from two sides, then we get back x transpose times x, where we don't know x yet, but we know that for some x, this is true. Let's call this matrix x transpose times x, let's call it B. And then now we will turn to the second step, when we would like to solve B equals x transpose times x to find x. Here we will use a very nice idea from linear algebra, which we already learned at 1A natural sciences math, is that we take the eigendecomposition of B. As a recap, what it is doing is that we take a matrix E, which will consist of the eigenvectors of B, and the eigenvectors of B will be the columns of A, E, and that strange symbol which looks like a triangle, that's a capital lambda, that's a diagonal matrix with the eigenvalues of B. And we learn that if we multiply E by lambda by E transpose, then it gives back B. This is the eigendecomposition of B. And now what we want to, and this is possible to find this E and lambda. So now what we want to solve is E lambda E transpose equals X transpose X. And here, if you just visually look at this equation, you can see that taking X equals lambda to the 1/2 times E transpose, this is a solution to this equation, because if you calculate X transpose X, then you can see that it exactly gives back B. And then we are done, because this is exactly what we wanted. We wanted to get back x, and then we can extract the actual vectors and hence the actual points in our final configuration, because they are the columns of x. But there is something strange. Maybe we missed something, but we didn't really talk about the dimensions of these matrices. In how many dimensions did we want to find a solution? Well, so this X matrix is a square matrix. So now we managed to find a solution in n dimensions, where n is the number of points. But this is not what we really wanted. If it is possible to find an arrangement in just k dimensions, where k is smaller than n, then we would like to find that arrangement, and we would not like to use all the n dimensions. But we are lucky because using some linear algebra, we can see that in the case when it's possible to find the solution in k dimensions, then simply the eigenvalues of B will m minus k eigenvalues of B will simply be zero, which means that after, if we calculate x from the formula lambda to the 1/2 times e transpose, then it will have many rows which are simply zero. And what are the rows of the matrix X? They are the coordinates of the points in our final configuration. So it means that we can just simply ignore those rows, and then we will have our desired solution in k dimensions by taking just the k non-zero rows. So this is magic, basically. Yes. But as I mentioned before, it is not always the case that a perfect arrangement of the points is possible. What to do in this case? In this case, we would like to still find an arrangement of points which produces distances which are very close to the desired distances which are in the input. And this error minimization thing, what we want to minimize, in this case is actually called a Kruskal stress, which has an input as an input a final configuration, and the stress means the error of this configuration with respect to the input distance matrix. And in this case, we would like to minimize this error, this stress. But if we cannot perfectly reproduce the distances, then we would like to add one additional constraint, that we would like to use just at most three dimensions, because there is no point in using six or seven dimensions. It will still not be a perfect match, and it just makes our life much harder. So there is no point in adding extra four dimensions to get a little bit better precision, but we can interpret data and plot data just up to three dimensions. And here, there is a very important point. So the previously discussed Torgerson algorithm, actually, by some little modification, works for this case as well. So it can be proven that by modifying the Torgerson algorithm somehow, which we will discuss soon, that algorithm will give back a configuration which minimizes this stress. And what do we have to change? The idea is that if we go back to this slide, we simply have to take the k largest eigenvalues of B. So if you look at the diagonal matrix capital lambda, we just have to take the k largest eigenvalues and the corresponding eigenvectors. And we do not use the other eigenvectors and eigenvalues. And then after that, if we multiply everything out and calculate x, then we will get the solution in k dimensions. Why is it optimal? Intuitively, by leaving out just the smaller eigenvalues, we can see that the impact of the small eigenvalues, the small eigenvectors, is very small. So we want to have just the dominant ones, which matter very much when we actually want to reconstruct the distance matrix, because this is a long chain. We have x, then b depends on x, and if we go back to the previous slides, d2 also depends on b. So if we leave out just not too important parts from x, then this will not cause much error in b, and hence it will not cause too much error in d either. So it means that we can get a pretty good result in this case. How many dimensions should we actually use? There's a rule called an elbow rule, or you can think of it as diminishing returns. So we would like to choose the number of dimensions such that adding one to the dimensions wouldn't improve the accuracy too much, but it would make our life much harder when interpreting it. In this example, you can see that we should probably choose two dimensions or three dimensions. There is no point in going to four dimensions because we don't get much better precision, but it makes our life like much harder to interpret the data in four dimensions. So let's now look more closely at the possible input distance matrices. Here I quoted distance because it's not always a distance as we think about it. So there is the first case when the input distance matrix corresponds to Euclidean distances. And this exactly means that there is a way to arrange endpoints such that they perfectly reproduce the desired distances. There is a way to check that an input distance matrix is Euclidean or not. It's called Schoenberg criterion. I will not talk about it here. But also we can check this by running the Torgerson algorithm and then seeing if the result gives us a perfect match or not. There is a second category which is less strict. It's called metric. In this case, what we want from our input distance matrix is just to have four very basic properties. An example of these properties is that we want it to be symmetric at least. So we want the distance between point I and J to be the same as the distance between point J and I. And also we would like triangle inequality to hold, which we all know what it is. And there is a third category, when we cannot assume anything about the input matrix. This is very, very common when the input matrix is constructed from human feelings, as in the case of color vision, because then the entries are just random numbers of what people think about the colors. So there is no guarantee that, for example, triangle inequality will hold. So just as an example to clarify these three categories, you can see this, the three triangles below. The left one corresponds to the Euclidean distances. That's actually a real triangle and the real 4 points. The distances are also real. On the second one, you can see actually it's cheating. So this geometry cannot exist. Even though the triangle inequality and symmetry holds, it's not possible to arrange these ABCD points with these 5.1 and 10 as distances. And the third one is completely rubbish. You can see that even triangle inequality does not hold. So we cannot even hope to arrange these 4 points in any number of dimensions. And then depending on the input distance matrix, we might approach our goal in a different way. So if it's a simple Euclidean distance matrix, then we simply run the Torgerson algorithm, which we discussed before. If it is a metric matrix, it means that there is still some quantitative structure in the data. We can still assume some things. And in this case, there is an algorithm called stress majorization, which is really exciting. We will not talk about it here, which can solve our problem in this case. But again, it's important to mention that in the metric and in the dissimilarity case, it's not possible to perfectly reproduce the data. So we are again aiming to minimize the error. And in this case, there is no closed form solution for this. This stress majorization algorithm is also an iterative algorithm. But what we will talk about is the third case when the input distance matrix is completely arbitrary. It's just a dissimilarity matrix. Well, actually, we will actually assume that similarity holds, but it's not too important that this is something which we can assume even from human beings. And in this case, we can also run the classical Torgerson algorithm and see, and as we discussed, it minimizes the errors regarding this input distance matrix. Then why don't we use it simply? It turns out that it's more sensible not to believe people and not to believe that the numbers they wrote in the matrix are actually representative. So what we should rather do is interpret those numbers as just an ordering of the n times n distances. So we will not, so it will not matter for us what the actual numbers are in that input distance matrix. We will consider just the order of the entries from the matrix. It's arguable, it's not trivial why it is better, but after some research, nowadays the accepted opinion is that it's better to treat the input distance matrix just as an order, or just as a ranked order. And it's actually misleading to treat the numbers as distances and running the Torgerson algorithm on that, because that will not produce desired configurations. So now let's talk about the third case when we have just the dissimilarity matrix. And in this case, we again want to minimize some stress. But as we discussed before, there is an additional degree of freedom here because we are free to change the input distance matrix until the order is preserved. So this is the same as saying that just the order matters. Put it in another way, it means that we can change the entries in the input distance matrix until the order of the n times n entries are the same. And now we have 2 degrees of freedom. One is actually configuring and arranging the points, and the other one is modifying the input distance matrix. And you can see in the formula that there is a function f here in the stress, which accounts for this transformation of the input distance matrix, and it has to be a monotonic function, because it but what it means is that it basically preserves the distances of the entries. And as even for the metric case, of course, for this case, there is no analytical solution either. So we can aim just for some nice iterative algorithm. And this is what Kruskal did. We learned about Kruskal's algorithm in 1A algorithms, but no, this is not. This is a different Kruskal's algorithm. He invented quite a few algorithms. The idea of his iterative algorithm is the following. We have the 2 degrees of freedom. We can change the input distance matrix, and we can of course put our points somewhere in the space. And what it is doing is that it is alternately, so in an alternating manner, it brings the two distance matrices closer to each other. So first of all, we start out from an initial configuration, and then we read out the distances from our let's say random configuration, and of course it will be very far away from the desired distances in the input. But then we will modify the input distance matrix somehow to bring it closer to the distances observed in our configuration. And then for this modified input distance matrix, if the difference now is small enough, then we simply terminate and report the current arrangement of points. Otherwise, we use the other degree of freedom, is that we fine-tune the current arrangement of points with respect to the modified input distance matrix. And how we do this is simply running the Torgerson algorithm, the classical multidimensional scaling, with input being the current modified version of the input input distance matrix. It might sound a bit confusing, but basically the idea is what you should take away is that now we have the 2 degrees of freedom, and we would like to first improve one and then bring closer to the other, then bring closer the first until they are close to each other as much as we wanted and as much as it is possible. It's possible that it finds just a local minimum, as for any iterative optimization algorithm. In this case, we might need to do multiple runs or choose the initial configuration in a clever way. If you are a bit confused, don't worry, because now we will turn to applications, which is, and for this you don't need to understand the actual mathematical underlying details. These are like breathtaking stories, in my opinion. I really like these applications. The first one is from mathematics, and then we will see some other from other areas as well. This is a very famous problem. We have a graph, and we would like to plot this graph somehow to see the structure. For instance, we often have graphs which represent networks, like telecommunication networks, and then it's very important to plot them in some dimensions to see what is close to each other, who talked with other people often, who did not talk with other people that often. And this intuitively and naturally leads us to multidimensional scaling, where we know the distances, which are the edge length, basically, and then we would like to plot it in some dimensions. Another one is from social sciences. In an experiment, people were asked to compare countries. There was a list of countries, and people had to tell how different they are pairwise. So they had to fill out a matrix, basically. And the purpose of this research was to understand how people think about countries. More precisely, in how many dimensions, along how many features people think about countries when they are comparing it. And it turns out that the elbow is at 2 dimensions. What it means is that in one dimension, it was not possible to plot the countries on a line such that it preserves the distances which we got from people when they were asked how different countries are. But if we move to 2 dimensions, we managed to get an arrangement of points where the distances are very well preserved. And this means that people are thinking about countries along two lines. Furthermore, researchers went further and they wanted to interpret what these two lines are actually. Here it's important to turn back to a point which I mentioned before. This is rigid transformations, that even though we fixed that we find the center solution, we can still rotate the points around the center. And it will still give the same distances. So when we want to give some meaning to the two axes on the plot, we have to be careful because maybe the meaningful axes are rotated, as you can see in this case, for example. It turned out that if we take the two axes as the two which we can see on the figure, one is developed to developing and the other is pro-Western to pro-communist, then by taking these two axes, it's very likely that people actually think along these two axes. How can we check it? We can check it by simply looking at the axis and see that the countries along the axis are actually their exposure to that attribute, like developing attribute, is increasing along the axis. And also these two axes are perpendicular to each other, so it's very possible that these are actually the two dimensions which people use. Another one is from linguistics. It's very common for people to misunderstand some words, some sentences, or even some letters, especially if you are not a native speaker of the language. And it's even worse if there is a noisy environment where you cannot exactly hear what they are saying. And in this experiment, they calculated how many times letter A1 is confused with letter A2. So for each possible pair of letters, they calculated the number of times they are confused with each other. And you can see that this leads naturally to an input distance matrix, but you first, of course, have to somehow invert it, because now the greater the number is, the more similar they are. There are some techniques to invert it. I will not talk about it, but for example, you can take a very large number and subtract the number of times they were confused with each other from this large number. That's one way. And after running a multidimensional scaling on this input distance matrix, in this case, the axes were also interesting, but this is not what the researchers were looking for. Here they were looking for clusters. And here we turn back to the three main objectives, which I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, which is dimensionality reduction, feature attribution, and clusters. In the previous example, we could see that what was very important is to know the features, the two axes, like what they are for a human, what they mean, and also how many dimensions we needed. And here, clustering is very important. As you can see on the figure on the right, there are letters E, V, D, B, P, T, which all have the E sound. And this research proved that people confuse mostly those sounds with each other, which have an E sound in it. This is kind of intuitive, but still I think it's a nice result. Another one is also from social sciences. Here, in an experiment, researchers took some countries and five aspects of that countries, which are numerical aspects like the GDP, life expectancy, and so on. And you can see that treating these five aspects as five coordinates, we can clearly put the countries in a five-dimensional space. And after putting it in a five-dimensional space, reading the distances from this five-dimensional space between the countries, we can construct a Euclidean distance matrix. And this will be our input for this multidimensional scaling run, because in this case, the goal is to reduce the dimensions and trying to plot the countries in just two dimensions, such that the distances should be almost as well preserved as in five dimensions from where the data actually came. And it turns out that it's actually possible, and the two axes are how developed a country is, and the other axis should be the GDP. And what the conclusion is from this experiment is that if you know the development rate of a country and the GDP of a country, then it implies other important measures. like life expectancy, total fertility rate. So it means that we can think about it as like these feature vectors are not linearly independent, but they are dependent on each other. This example is from politics. It's a very interesting example. So political parties often describe themselves using various tags. Like you can imagine like left wing, liberal, right wing, and there are many tags present in politics. But what the researchers in this experiment were excited about is to understand how many dimensions these political parties actually have. Because it's very confusing to see these tags and these names of political parties. Whereas, as we will see, it turns out that underlying these confusing names and tags, there are just very few ideas along which political parties put themselves in the picture of politics. And here, how they calculated the distances, so the input to the multidimensional scaling run, was that they looked at parliamentary voting, and they calculated how many times two parties voted in a different way for a proposal. And if two parties voted always voted like the opposite of the other party, one voted yes, other voted no, it means that the two parties are far away from each other. And this will be the input to the multidimensional scaling run. And after doing a run, it turns out that we can plot the countries very well in one or two dimensions, such that the distances are well preserved. Long ago, it was one dimensional, but now it is starting to become two dimensional. And what it means that nowadays countries are actually political parties are actually located along a two-dimensional space. So it means that when you create a political party, you can create yourself, but by telling how much you understand, how much you agree with one idea, and how much you agree with the second idea, and this will completely define your party. And to find out what these two aspects are, a technique called issue vectors was used. Researchers drew some aspects on the resulting plot, like ethical, environment, immigration. So these are some important aspects in politics. And by looking at this figure, it's very likely that the two features along which the parties are actually thinking, one is the left-right or decentralization, and the other one is along the lines of environment, deregulation, taxes versus spending, and immigration. Because we can see that they are almost orthogonal to each other, and it's very likely that these are the two dimensions along which political parties actually think under the hood. And let me conclude this talk by a funny example, which is from the world of football. This was also an academic research, where teams from the Spanish championship were observed. How can we construct a distance matrix from football teams? It's not too hard. In a championship, what we have to know is that each team plays with each other team once in a season. And how we measure the distance between two teams is their result against each other. This is not yet a single number, but we can like treat the goal difference in their result. If Barcelona defeated Real Madrid 6-1, then their difference will be 6 minus 1, which is 5. And this way, we can construct a distance matrix and then run the multidimensional scaling algorithm on this to find where the football teams are actually located in the space. And the researchers did it in this case in three dimensions, as we can see in the figure. Also, it was a time series. They added some time series comparisons, so they did this analysis for multiple years. This is why you can see multiple points for the same team. But basically, you can see that there are six clusters of the teams which are kind of separated from each other. For example, cluster A contains Real Madrid and Barcelona, which are the two best teams in the Spanish championships, and there are five other clusters. And it does not look too surprising yet, but it turns out that these plots can actually be used by football coaches. How? Let's assume that you are a football coach and you have a team which is like not a bad team but also not the best team. So it's somewhere in the middle in the overall rankings. And there is another team which has the same overall score as you. So you both defeated the same number of teams in the championships. But it turns out that on the plot, you are very, very far away from each other, which means that you are in some sense very much different, even though you have the same points in the championships. How can this happen? It can happen, for example, if you defeated different teams. You defeated teams A, B, C and lost against D, E, F, for instance, and the other team defeated teams D, E, F and lost against A, B, C. And then how can you improve your performance? Basically, go and inspect that other team, because it means that they are doing something very well, which you are doing wrong, and you are doing something very well, which they are doing wrong. So if you combine the strengths of the two teams, you can get a team which is very strong and maybe win the championship. Thank you for your attention.